Okay, and away we go. I'm just slowing things down a little bit here. It seems like everyone is kind of trying to catch their breath, so we'll slow it down a little bit. It's not seeming to show any video here. Okay, there we go. Just slow it down a little bit. That doesn't mean I'm slowing down. I'm going faster than ever. But I'm saying, well, there's some important videos. That the CPR, spiritual CPR, is a very important video. It marks a watershed. Shows the fluidity that we can have, and the humor and the fluidity with truth, and we're not bogged down in the historicalness of anything. Actually, now, can we move on from the past? Absolutely. I've been studying the past. Why? So we can move on from it, and we're not stuck in it. I'm not stuck in it. And others will try to say, yeah, well, we can't because we're stuck here. And I'll just say, you know, no, that's not a, like the filioque, which has caused the great schism in 1054 between the Roman Catholic Church and the Eastern Orthodox Church, you know, proceeds from the Father and the Son. What is the actual, it states, here, and in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the italics and the Son. That's the filioque. Filioque. Okay, now we have the right pronunciation. Everybody knows what I'm talking about. The filioque is the italics, and from the Son. This is really basically at the root of the schism. There's lots of factors, but that's one that really sticks in their craw, because everybody's craw, because this was added to the Nicene Creed. The Nicene Creed was supposed to be definitive, and it wasn't supposed to be able to be changed. And then in like the 6th century, the Rome changed it, and the Pope of Rome decided to change and add in that from the Father and the Son. So the Holy Spirit comes from the Father and the Son. Now, people, I've said Jesus is back. He is back. So they might be wondering, well, what is Jesus saying about these things? And I don't know. I haven't had a recent conversation with him. But certainly, A Course in Miracles makes it pretty clear what the Holy Spirit is. Well, very clear, very clear. So it does clear up the filioque. Is that right? Filioque? Let me see. Filioque. Yeah. It does clear it up. It does clear it up. So we're not stuck there. It's the Holy Spirit is really God the Son being blessed by God the Father with remembrance that God the Son really is God the Son. So it's the functioning is that of God the Son, but it's a blessing, like a reassurance of God the Father to God the Son. Yes, you really are God the Son, and you can tell yourself this. So it is from the Father and the Son. This is correct. So the filioque is, you'd say, it's correct. Now, you know, how does that resolve? Well, it's a different explanation of why it's correct. So maybe that this schism can just, we can just say, you know, it's time to move on. It's time to move on from the past. And looking at the past, I'm doing this massive reevaluation of the past. And there's nothing that we should say, well, we can't move on from this. We absolutely can move on from everything. This is my recognition. We move on from everything. Who's the most central figure of early Christianity? From the Roman standpoint, Theodosius, Emperor Theodosius, was the one that actually made the Christianity the official religion of the Roman Empire, and looked the other way when the destruction of the pagan temples, sacrificial cult, etc., made the pagan holidays actual work days, and then made Sunday the day of rest for the Christian day. And so that's where it really, you know, was solidified. Constantine really just made edicts that said we're not going to persecute anymore and return the property, but he didn't make it the official religion of the empire. It was Theodosius who did a lot of things and really said this is it. Now, the primacy of the papacy in Rome is another big issue where the Eastern Orthodox says, well, the Schism of 1054, where they finally excommunicated each other and said, okay, there's a schism that gradually got worse and worse and worse. They said, well, the Pope in Rome is first among equals. Keep in mind that Christianity really strongly formed in the eastern part, Eastern Orthodox area, like our the Georgia, the area of Georgia, I think, was the first, or was that the state, official state, that Christianity was official state religion. They called it something else back then. Iberia, I think, Iberia. And Georgia, what we call Georgia right now, and then the areas in Cappadocia, the areas in Syria, there are areas in Mesopotamia, there's areas in Africa, the Eritrea and Somalia area, in Ethiopia, you know, areas in Algeria and what we call Algeria and Libya and Egypt, and Rome was actually pretty much on the side of Christianity for quite some time, actually. And the reason why they went to the Pope of Rome, it was because they were kind of neutral, because they were kind of out of the loop. So they're kind of neutral on all these disputes that were going on in Christendom. So they'd say, well, we can go to the Pope of Rome and they'll make a neutral decision. So this is where the Pope of Rome got their authority, is for sort of being a mediator. But they didn't ever, nobody from the East ever said, well, there's some sort of primacy to Rome. It really didn't work that way. And they said, well, you know, Peter's established a church in Antioch. And you know, there's questions that he wasn't really the first bishop of Rome, they say. And so there's, you know, they say, hey, you know, first among equals. So there's something there that's very strong. And so we tend to think of Catholicism as Roman Catholicism, but actually Christianity heavily rooted in Eastern areas like Turkey, the Levant, the Holy Land, Egypt, you know, the whole that part of the Roman Empire stretching into the area known as Assyria back then, the Mesopotamian Valley, up into Armenia. Armenia was very important, you know, up the Balkans, even it stretched up into Russia eventually. So the Greece, of course, Bulgaria, Romania area. These were heavily, heavily Christian areas. This is the strongholds where there was a state religion way before it became the state religion of Rome, you see, or the Roman Empire for sure. So there's all this history of Christianity which I've been going through, and you know, you look at all the emperors of Rome too. I've gone through the whole situation really again, and you know, it's all trivial. It's all a side trip. It's all not worth clinging to. There's no need to cling to it at all. We can just simply move on. There's nothing there that would prevent us from moving on, and not anywhere. You know, I can't find us anything, not a single thing. You know, we talk about apokatastasis, which is, you know, origin, the idea of a final ingathering of all things to God, to perfection, the original perfection. Apokatastasis, something like apokatastasis. You know, there was all these, and then Arianism, which was very popular in the Roman Empire, especially in Rome. That first 3-4 centuries, Arianism was very strong, which said Jesus was just a man that was adopted by God. All these things that they battled over and struggled over, and they said, well, this is heretical, this is anathema, excommunicated. You know, the definition of the Trinity, and they. Okay, so these are all examples of people, or not people, but minds that are kind of beginners. Okay, but good stuff. It's all good stuff. I mean, origin, and then also how does it get passed on? There's different beliefs in that. One belief is that it's the parents, human parents, form the soul. Others is that God, creation, and God creates the soul at the moment of conception or a little bit afterwards. There's differing, and then there's another one too. You know, there's arguments over these things. These things have like been bedeviling us for thousands of years, and it's easy to just dismiss all of them, wave of the hand. I can do it easily. It's much ado about nothing, actually, in terms of false premises about this. When does the soul life begin and the human life begin? And this is all a dream. It's all a dream. And it's all pretension. It's all pretension, all of it. So these questions all have false premises to them, really. They're not set on a right premise, a right foundation. So the whole structure, basically, of history, Christian religious history, is been set on a wrong foundation. And they thought that, you know, that didn't matter. That they just assumed the foundation that they had was right. Because if it's too difficult to just say, well, my foundation is wrong, then people would say, oh my God, there's nothing we can do. You know, I mean, we can't do anything about it. It's just too difficult. Well, it is difficult to replace a foundation while you're still living in the house, but it is very doable. Right? You just do it in sections, so to speak. I mean, you can put a jack on the house, and you can knock down like a whole wall of a foundation, one side of the whole side of a house. You just put jacks and hold the house up, and then you can pour new concrete and put a new foundation in, and then that's solid, and then you can go to another aspect of the house and do that. So you absolutely can replace the foundation while you're living in the house. And that's really what we have to do. Our foundation is wrong. Our foundation is absolutely mistaken in so many ways. And so, you know, the house that they had was just like, whoa, this foundation is not stable. What do we do? And let's go to the, you know, Pope of Rome and the Emperor of Rome and appeal and get a judgment here. And let's see if we can agree on something. And, you know, and they're just struggling to, how can we put this house in order while it still seems to be all very seismic in its instability? And so they didn't get it right. That's plain and simple. That's all. We just have to say 2,000 years, we haven't got it right yet. What's the big deal? That's only 2,000 years. And we can get it right. We can get it right now. Jesus is back to help us get it right. That's all. And of course, what his real message was for us to practice in this form of, yes, I am both and neither, absolutely in the heart and absolutely not in the heart. I am both and neither. Yes, I am both and neither. Absolutely dwelling in pure spaciousness and absolutely not dwelling in pure spaciousness. Yes, I am both and neither. Absolutely love Jesus and absolutely don't love Jesus. Yes, use anything. Everything is grist for the mill with this practice, and we should practice this. And this puts us in the groove, as it were. It puts us in the groove, and I've noticed this. Yeah, I can even talk faster than Trump. That is true. It puts us in the groove, and when someone asks us to define, well, how did you get in the groove? We're out of the groove, just like that. And so this bedeviled me my entire life, and I finally solved it yesterday. And I just said, yeah, I'm both in the groove and not in the groove. I both figured it out and didn't figure it out. I both know how to get into it and don't know how to get into it. And by saying this, I stayed in the groove. I stayed in the groove. And I said, guys, it's a miracle. It's a miracle. I've been struggling with this my entire life, trying to come up with some answer, or not answer, just though I don't want to give any answer to it, so I'm going to be quiet. And nothing I did worked, and then finally I just gave this double form of, yes, I'm both and neither, absolutely in the groove, and absolutely not in the groove. I absolutely did this, and absolutely didn't do this. I'm absolutely like this, and absolutely not like this. To put it in real simple terminology, I'm absolutely like, yes, I'm both and neither absolutely like this and absolutely not like this. This is absolutely me and absolutely not me. So you flatten out concepts. This for me is the highest, most effective teaching there is. And, you know, to just sum up the history of Christianity, Jesus came and said, look, you need to practice in an effective way. And, you know, this is what you need to do. So consider doing that. And we've been squabbling for 2,000 years over, you know, crumbs. Now, in A Course in Miracles, Jesus makes it plain he's not happy about religion that was formed around him. He's not thrilled by it at all, to say the least. You know, he's not angry. Jesus is not angry like that at all. But he is saying, basically, you know, you got to do a lot better than that. That's not it. And ultimately, real religion is practice. Right practice. It's not talking about right practice. It's not thinking about it. It's actually doing it. If you're not actually doing right practice, you're not really religious at all. You might be a philosopher or something, but you're not a real Christian, not really a Christian at all. Jesus told us, really, we didn't have the ears to hear it. The Holy Spirit has to help out, but just for instance, the whole bread of life situation, which the Catholic Church was in Mass last Sunday, and they had this John 6:47-55 or something like that about this. The famous, you know, my body is the flesh and the blood. You know, for sacrifice my body is and so that's the Eucharist, is you're taking the actual literal blood and flesh of Jesus. But if you look at the overall context of everything that Jesus said, he makes it very clear that the bread of life that he brings for us to give us eternal life is his teachings, okay, his spiritual words and teachings. That is his body. See, he referred to his body as a spiritual body, and he said, the flesh profiteth nothing. Okay, the flesh profiteth nothing. So, he's really talking about the bread that he gives us is his spiritual teaching. The word that he gives us, the word, the spiritual truth, these teachings of how to practice properly. This is what he meant. To eat of that means to do it, to chew on it, like food. You know, like every day we eat food. Well, what he's really saying to us is you need to put this on a level like food, as far as it's important. You have to feed your spirit. Okay, there's spiritual food. He said, I'm really spiritual food for you. Not flesh and blood food for you, but spiritual food. And people are saying, well, how do we eat spiritual food? Spiritual practices are. So the manna that came down from heaven, which gives us eternal life, is actually Jesus' understanding of how to practice properly. And once we see this, they say, oh my gosh, yeah. But I saw in church, I read this, I said, wow, it's very easy to misinterpret this if you take it out of context. And they certainly do. They just brush right over it, you know, like autopilot. They're on autopilot. Church is on autopilot, as you would expect. Just like as we're driving, we're used to a certain route, we just go on autopilot. You know, it's not a condemnation or anything. It's just what happens. We get on autopilot. We don't realize it. We miss the turnoffs. So this is the trouble in the world. People are on autopilot. How do you break through this autopilot mode? I don't know, you know. I'm trying, but it's not working very well. every day you have to challenge this autopilot mode. And I'm still on a certain amount of autopilot, I know, so I have to keep challenging it every day, challenge it. I remember I used to be so, well, I mean, it's a tough road, but it's a road we have to take. And you can't take a soft line on this issue of spiritual practice of religion. You cannot take a soft line. What's a soft line? Soft line means you don't do it. Then you're going to fail. And then you're going to blame others. Well, take care. I'm so suffering. You need to help me with my suffering. And you try to bind others to your, you know, the consequences of a failure, which is really mental instabilities that get projected, fear that gets projected, the ego gets projected, arrogance, you know. It's not right to ask somebody else to suffer for that for you. You know, so if you take a soft line, you're failing. And, you know, this has been the problem. This has been the problem. Men and women, both taking a very soft line. And today, this being peddled, the soft line is hey, you know, it's okay, the soft line. You know, it's being peddled so severely now. And, you know, I tell people, you have to take a hard line. There's no two ways around it. And this is what Jesus does. He says this is a very hard line. You know, you cannot make any exceptions to truth at all. And therefore, we do have to set down our concepts. We have to zero them out, and we have this continuity problem about judgment. We do have to set our judgment down, but we want to honor our creativity, so we keep the form. Well, how do you do that? We temporarily keep the form. We right practice. So right practice is the way. It actually is the way. And Jesus, of course, was saying, I am a spiritual body. I am spirit. I am true. You know, I am the truth. I am the way, the truth and the way and the life. And he's talking not about his physical, the physical appearance or flesh at all, but spirit, spiritual truth. And so this practice has been suggested to me by the Holy Spirit. Filioque, is that right? Filioque. It comes from the Father and the Son. It proceedeth from the Father and the Son, Holy Spirit. We don't even have to worry. It's better to do the practice. So it's amazing how we were able to procrastinate, and now we've procrastinated so long that this soft line is being sold to the world right now. And this is the big lie. This is the big lie that I've been railing against my whole life, and say it's going to be disastrous for everyone here. Is you cannot take a soft line, because that just keeps you in the default position, which is trying to pretending to be dead, and trying to have an authentic death. So you're going to, you know, if you take a soft line and you don't really work at it, you know, you're going to fail. There's no question about it. The idea that, well, you know, Jesus will make some accommodation for that, and you don't go to eternal damnation. That's nonsense. That's another false doctrine, which the apocatastasis of Origen, who is one of the, you know, the great writers in the history of the church. You have Gregory the Great and what? Augustine and Ambrose and Jerome are the main, what they call the fathers of the church, doctors, some of the main doctors of the church, early fathers of the church that did all the writing. And the Eastern Orthodox has some others, St. Gregory of Nazza, I don't know, Nazanian or something, and Basil, and St. John of Chrysostom, something like that. They have three doctors, fathers like that, who are also great writers in theology and structuring the church. You know, the church had all this, they've got this theology together, and they structured the church. Now, Jerome was a great translator. He translated the Hebrew Bible into Latin. Or was that Origen? Maybe it was Jerome. But, Origen was somewhat of a Platonist, and had, you know, he believed in reincarnation. He believed that every souls will be eventually completely returned to their natural state. And actually, you know, Origen was closer to the truth, and he was eventually anathematized. And so, you know, you had to, all these barbarians from the north, let's be honest, I mean, they came in sacking Rome, eventually you had to accommodate them, and the efforts to accommodate them, they weren't aware of all Hellenistic philosophy and Judaism. You know, they were pagan goddess worshippers, what they were, from the northlands of Scandinavia, from Germany area, you know, and the Gauls, the Goths, the Visigoths, the Lombards were actually from like, you know, Scandinavia, the Lombards that came down into Italy. They were just like constant invasions and sackings and battles, etc. And you know, they were converted, but what did they know? What kind of, you know? I mean, when you're talking about like the scholars of Alexandria, you're talking about like Hellenized Jews that you know goes back thousands of years, maybe of study of the law and careful consideration and rhetoric and reason and all this kind of, you know, philosophy, and then the Greek combination of the Greek philosophy. I mean, these people were intellectual giants and very sophisticated, cosmopolitan, you know, And here, here come the northern tribes, you know, pillaging and sacrificing, human sacrificing, and which they certainly did do. Especially the Druids were known for that. And then they said, "Hey, well, here's his religion. Why don't you convert to it? You'll do good in battle. You know, put the symbol, you know, on your shield, which supposedly Constantine did. Christian symbol on the shield and went into battle." With the river Frigidus, something like that. There's a battle in the valley there, and defeated the Western emperor, so to speak, by putting the symbol. Or was that the Battle of the Bridge of Milvin, something like that? Yeah. Anyway, these warrior clans that they were, a lot of them were converted just because the Romans beat them and defeated them in battle. They said, well, this is get our power from our god. See, in the Romans used to place statues of Jupiter and whatever on the battlefield in front of them, and say this is where we get our power. We get our power from our gods. That's why they sacrificed to the gods. Did you know that the Romans would not do anything in public life, any important decision whatsoever, and they had to take counsel, they had to get the opinion of an augur. What is augury? Well, augury was extremely important in Rome, believe it or not. They had to consult this oracle, we called an augur. And what is augury? Well, this is pretty amazing. I know it was going to blow your mind. It blew mine because I was ignorant of this. Learn something every day. And this is what it actually is. Augury as practiced in Rome, which was a super extensive, all pervasive, and you had to get the opinion of an augur before you made any decision. Any government decision, any important decision, it was all important and completely necessary. Augury was actually, the augurs were trained to get the answers of God to the questions through the vocalization of birds and the flight of birds and the positioning of birds. Reading birds, that's what augury is. There are two different kinds of birds. The ones that they read the voices of, and the ones that read the position or flight of them. And so the augurs, they would put a question to God, and then they would become aware of what the birds were doing, what happened in relation to birds. Like a bird would fly off to the right side or something, and they'd say, ah, this is God's answer to the question. Or there'd be some birds, over in the left side or something. Or there's all this, it was a skill, and the people were trained in augury. Now, this actually came from Egypt. Augury goes back to ancient Egypt for sure. But this was the official state position. This was central to Roman life, was augury. They would not conduct a battle at all until they consulted an augur. And there was a class of these people. I was astonished when I found out about this. It is just mind blower, but I recognize this is true. Now, the Greeks, of course, similar, except they went to the oracles, Oracle of Delphi, the Temple of Apollo at Delphi. The Pythia, the oracle there, was a woman priestess, and her word was absolute gospel, and she was never wrong. I mean, the position was, it's infallible. So the Greeks already had this infallible source of response from God. The ancient people asked God all the time, constantly asking God for answers. What should I do? What should I do? What should I do? What should I do? And they felt that they could, get answers in various ways. Also, divination of the entrails of the sacrificial animals was something they did a lot of too. But augury, the birds, this was like a science to them, an art and a science. And it was all pervasive. The Oracle of Delphi only was asked like about nine days out of the year could you even ask the questions. And pretty interesting stuff about what they've discovered there, that they feel that the priestess went into a hallucinatory state from ethylene, that it was gases was coming up through fissures in the rocks, actually. And this puts you into like a hallucinatory state where you're able to answer and if you get too much of it, then you go into a wild frenzied state, which often happens there. If you go over a certain point, parts per million, or something like 0.20 parts per million, then you go from coherent state into almost virtually incoherent state, which often happened there. And they also chewed on oleander leaves and burned oleander leaves, which that also produces also an altered state. So they're using drugs, basically, drug state. And the oracle would often put things in an ambiguous way, whereas if you put a certain punctuation here, it's one meaning. If you put it here, it's the opposite meaning. And there were experts at saying things in ambiguous ways, so no matter what happened, they could say, well, of course, the oracle is right. You see? We just didn't interpret it properly. Well, they're right. So the oracle was literally infallible, never wrong. And the Greeks used this for a long time. And this... You know, a lot of this came from ancient Egypt. Ancient Egypt used oracles and augury and all this kind of stuff. Really astonishing. But I understand it. It's not something to be condemned, actually. I have actually found that, well, why do you think the Holy Spirit is a symbol of a bird? Now you know, really. It's augury. It has its roots in augury, really. I mean, that symbol. The bird coming down, the bird coming down like this. Oh, you see the bird, and that gives the answer. Well, I have noticed in my life that actually birds do give certain, they're quite extraordinary, actually. And there have been quite a few times where I've been asking the Holy Spirit for an answer, and birds suddenly, appear like a big white bird will just suddenly float through the sky. I just had some astonishing things happen with birds. And so I think that, it's not completely crazy. We would look at that and say, well, that's absolutely nuts. I don't think it is absolutely nuts. Birds are somehow spiritually connected to some sort of... totality in some way, and there are certain, I can understand how they got into this in a certain way, but they were really into it. They wouldn't do anything without consulting an augur. And so it's just really a wild time, it's really a wild time there. We're in an oracular time right now, where the priestess, we're being taught that the priestess image of the female image of the priestess, like Delphi, is infallible. It's never wrong. Women are never wrong, and if it doesn't work out right, well, you just didn't understand, what you were supposed to do or something. It's amazing how we're going back to pagan times. We're very much in pagan times right now, which I've been, one of the main themes I've been pointing out. We are in extremely pagan times, and this means we're going back to an oracular sort of situation where, keep in mind that the ultimately the priestesses, the ancient cults are all goddess cults, Gaia cults. Aphrodite was a snake worshipping in Crete. It came from that. But what happened was that the male gods took over, like Zeus, so the female gods were not the ones on the very top. All the Vestal Virgins were in Rome on the very top, as were the Oracle Delphi and some other oracles. They controlled society still, but the male gods came in, and the pagan goddess worshippers very much resented that in some ways. Very, very strange history we've had. We're going back to pagan times here. We are a pagan nation, right? Believe it or not. Even though we say, well, Christianity is 2 billion people, these are not what you could say practicing Christians, okay? And a lot of what they follow is pagan, actually, a lot of it. And they have very little resistance anymore, some more so than others, but the resistance is crumbling. The resistance is crumbling. You got to take a hard line on truth. You have to practice, and if you don't practice, you know, you shouldn't be admitted, so to speak, to Christianity. And I don't care who you are, whether you're a woman or a man. And so there's this idea that we can't take a hard line on women at all. Well, that's not serving them well at all. And you know, the only hard line is on men. That you know, the very society is taking an extremely severe line on men, and no line at all on women. You know, let's just return to the oracle. Maybe that's the answer. This is what pagans really want to do. Let's just go back. That's what their aim is. You know, they say basically religion doesn't work, Christianity doesn't work. Let's return to the oracle. Let's return to you know the pagan religion. Religions where you know the earth mother. The fertility of the earth is personified as this is Gaia or Earth Mother. Various, you know, they use various terms for it. Most of the ancient pagan cults used, you know, venerated that, and they said, you know, let's just go back to nature. Let's do that. Christianity didn't work. Well, it didn't work because we didn't practice. It's not that Jesus was wrong. Jesus was absolutely right. There really is eternal life for us. There really is. So. It's just they didn't practice. They didn't practice enough, and they got hung up on stuff, and they made some wrong decisions. But all that stuff is relatively trivial and not a blockage. It's not like, you know, it's easy to just say, okay, let's just start practicing here. And it's easy to, you know, we keep the Trinity, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. That's something that is very useful. Okay, and I know Islam doesn't have that, but in Christianity they have that. It's very useful, and so you know, and does everything go back to God in its perfect nature? Well, yeah, just like a dream, you know, we never left. So, did we go back? Well, we awaken from the dream, but we never left. So same way we go back to it is sort of Gnostic, you know, really. I mean, Gnosticism is the idea that we have to be purified and the darkness has to be driven out and the light has to be redeemed from the darkness. You know, that's Gnostic duality. Gnosticism also has some very good features to it. All these various things have good features to it. But none of them really put it all together at all. And so what we have to do is honor our efforts, all these different efforts, you know, whatever they may be, all the way back through history. You know, I mean, Christianity cannot assume a position of superiority. They can say they've done a lot of good stuff, but it doesn't mean they're the only ones who've done some good stuff. I mean, Gnosticism had some good aspects to it. Hellenistic philosophy like Plato... it had a lot of good to it. Really, I mean, Plato was quite extraordinary, actually. Judaism has a lot of good to it, and you know, even polytheism, you know, has a lot of good to it. I mean, you know, the Romans trying to determine the will of God in their lives. You know, they just did it all sorts of ways. You know, they'd have chickens that they'd let out of a cage, and if the chickens did this, that meant that God wanted to do this. If the chickens ran away and wouldn't eat, that means, okay, there's a negative thing. They're trying to determine the will of God in their lives. They just went about it in different ways. And Christianity came in with this, you know, idea of vicarious atonement, which is, you know, it's that's an odd one, you know, but it follows certain ancient pagan teachings and customs, etc., and that comes from the Semitic tribalism and things, and they got try to fit it in this way and try to make it all work. So we've all done a lot of good stuff and just haven't really put it together properly yet. And this is what Jesus is telling us to do, is that look, it's time to put it all together now. And he really brought in A Course in Miracles to help us put it all together, actually. And I think it's being ignored by a lot of these people. They're so on autopilot. You know, they're just so on autopilot. They don't understand that there is a way to put it all together. And this enables us to honor our creativity and not be angry at ourselves. Forgive ourselves. He says, we got it. We just, because we see it, we say, oh, that's why I got that wrong. Because I had this problem. I'm like, you know, like the Oracle of Delphi, you know, just the influence that has had is that, she, you know, the woman's never wrong. She's always right. you can't win. In other words, you can't win. And this is paganism. You get this feeling like you just can't win. You know, when you're up against women right now, for instance, if they do something that's wrong, you can't win. You absolutely cannot win. The matter, it's catch 22 no matter what you do. It's like having to deal with the Oracle of Delphi. And that isn't right. That's not helpful at all. But in just realizing this, oh my gosh, this is the kind of trap we can get trapped into. And then that skews your ideology very severely. And then you forgive yourself. Say, oh my gosh, I see how maybe I might have been intimidated by all of that. You know, intimidated by the Roman decrees of this and this and that throughout history. I mean, I believe I've lived like a 33 lives on this planet throughout history. So there's a spider has reappeared here. And go back up to your palm tree. Okay. And so I've been intimidated all sorts of ways throughout history, to say the least. And I said, I'm tired of being intimidated. Very tired of being intimidated. And we don't have to apologize. We just can move on from it. This is interesting dust up with the whole... I'll get the spider to go up on the... So I can get the spider to go up on the palm tree so you don't have to bother us during the whole thing here. Yeah. Yeah, this dust up with Trump and this woman reporter. A very hard-boiled, tough lawyer, I believe. And... she's trying to basically tell him to stand down. Really, the goal of that whole debate is to tell Trump to quit. And he said, no, I'm not going to quit. I'm not going to stand down. And then, you know, he made comments that were misinterpreted. People had made certain misinterpretations based on what they thought that he really meant. And they say, you got to apologize. You got to stand down. And he said, no, I'm not. I didn't say anything wrong. I'm not standing down. And then the reporter said, well, I'm not... standing down either. He said, she should stand down. So I'm not standing down either. So, and they basically say, well, let's move on. Let's just move on from this. You know, we're not going to resolve this, really. Let's just move on. Fine. Okay. So, you know, we can do this. You know, we can do this. We're seeing that was handled in a way that the two adults, both of them very tough cookies. That woman's, like Trump used the term, a killer. You know, she's a real killer and very tough. And so, both of them say, look, okay, there's a dust up, a lot of nerves, dust up. Okay, fine, let's move on. It's kind of like a baseball fight, you know. After the shoving and pushing is over, okay, we move on, we drop it like that. But those who want to establish, you know, reestablish paganism, they can't move on from it. They can't move on from it. For them, the woman's always right. And what really means is soft line on practicing. We go back to oracles instead, you know, instead of actually practicing. See, Christianity we're supposed to realize that we can access the Holy Spirit within us, you see, instead of going to an oracle. Instead of going to the Oracle of Delphi or the Vestal Virgins, we can access the Holy Spirit. God's within us. We can access it. And we do that through right spiritual practice. So this is why Christianity is so important, as well as other religions, is they'd say, you know, the Holy Spirit is within everyone. And if you want to know, ask. Don't go to some professional augur or an oracle about what to do. This is the problem with pagan religion. And the United States was supposed to be a much self-governing place because most of the people here were Christians who came here, you see, and they're taught to, especially Protestants, for instance, that God is within us, the Holy Spirit was within us, and Catholics too are taught that. But you don't have to go through some big authority to tell you what to do. You're supposed to ask the Holy Spirit what to do through right prayers and contemplation here too. So we had more of a discerning in here, United States, Jewel. It's local, where we trusted one another that we will, in prayer, come up, you know, the Holy Spirit will guide us, our lives. This is what we have, you know, this is what we're supposed to be doing as Christians. And with the fall of Christianity right now, you're going towards the pagan, bureaucratic, imperial state where we ask the leader, the augurs, the oracles, you know, what should we do? We don't know what to do. We're just useful idiots here. So you pass the laws, you tell us. I mean, was a governor, Moonbeam, Jerry Brown, just told us today we can't use the term illegal aliens. The term alien is now, I guess, against the law in California. Can you believe that? He just it was some decree, you know, like acting like an emperor. He's really acting like a Roman emperor. That it's illegal to use the term alien. I mean, they're just losing our minds. If you know, these liberals just they're pagans. Let's put it plain and simple. They're failed Christians. A lot of them have come out of Christianity. They just gave up. They say, it's not working for me. Let's go back to the oracle. And let's set up a state, you know, statism. Let's set up statism. Is what they're going back to that. Severe regression that we're engaged in. Severe regression. But it's understandable. You know, it's understandable because we, you know, the foundation of Christianity is not quite right. They don't have the premise right. They have wrong premises. And so eventually the chickens are going to come home to roost, and they have now come home to roost. And, you know, there's no place to come home, which is just totally... very pagan, let's put it that way. So, it is the collapse of civilization, so to speak, Christian civilization now. We're experiencing it. Now, is Trump a Christian? Not really. No, he's just a businessman. Pragmatic, he's like an emperor type. Pragmatic, there's that spider again. Hey, spider, just... stay up here, would you? So we don't have to deal with you constantly going up and down, up and down, up and down, up and down like that. Ah. Yeah, he's just a mile-a-minute win-win-win businessman who's very sharp and very capable, but he's not a Christian. Let's be honest. He's not. He's a pagan. He even would admit some as such. Yeah, he goes to Presbyterian church or something, but he, you know, does he ever ask God for forgiveness or, you know, commune like that? And he says, no, never have, you know. He's a hard-driven win-win-win-win. I liken him to George Steinbrenner, the deceased owner of the Yankees, who was the same sort of character, just like, you know, win, got to win at all costs. We got to win. And they did. The Yankees did win. And he was an effective owner, even though it was tempestuous. But it was very, there was something good about it. You know, I like George Steinbrenner. You know, he Trump is a similar type, actually. Smarter, though. A lot smarter. And you know, he's just like an emperor. So, but, you know, is he going to revitalize Christianity? No. No. Is any candidate going to, electable candidate going to revitalize Christianity? No. I mean, Hillary Clinton is a pagan through and through and through. She's leading us back to the Oracle of Delphi. She thinks she is maybe the Oracle of Delphi, actually, with the way she acts. You know, it's basically say, well, I did what I needed to do, and everybody just needs to get over it, and let's move on, and that's it. So, you know, the Oracle's never wrong. So in the United States, we're doomed. You know, Christianity's doomed. Christianity around the world is doomed, actually. If you see what ISIS is doing in that area, which is the ancient seat of Christianity, actually, it's just terrible. Many people don't know that in the West, of the Eastern Orthodox. It was, you know, it was extremely important. That's the oldest area. That's where the patriarchs of Constantinople, Antioch, Jerusalem, Alexandria, that this has been going on for thousands of years, and it's under, you know, just massive attack and confusion, and it's the collapse of civilization is happening right now. Christian civilization is collapsing. There's no question about it. And the Pope is helping it along as fast as possible, actually. And so, because nobody's practicing, this is what I found out. This is what Jesus tells us over and over and over and over. These ideas are fine, but if they don't lead to going beyond words in terms of feeling the wowness behind the words, then it's no benefit to you. So we emphasize here, practice and feeling the wow, like wow. When you do this practice, yes, I am absolutely abiding in the heart and absolutely not abiding in the heart. And you start practicing this way and keep it going. Keep it going for 10 minutes, 20 minutes, an hour. Whatever comes up, you affirm and deny, you affirm and deny, you affirm and deny, like that. You will feel the most profound wow. And you will feel like you've done something that is quite extraordinary. Because you've zeroed out concepts, and therefore zeroed out concepts, there's nothing to judge. And you're free of judgment, and reality doesn't need to be judged. In fact, it cannot be judged. Who is there to judge? Who is there outside of reality, judging reality, and as opposed to what? There isn't anything as opposed to what. There's nothing outside of reality. So you cannot experience reality if you're in a judgmental state. It's impossible. So by this practice, it takes you out of a judgmental state. This is what has to be done. You know, however you do it, it has to be done. You cannot remain in a judgmental state and experience reality. It's impossible. That's why we say the final judgment is no judgment at all. And so we can practice this. And this is the genius that Jesus has brought us, is practice. We don't need theological squabbles and hermeneutics and exegesis and polemics and on and on and on. We don't need this extensive doxology of praise. No, practice, not praise. Jesus is not coming back to say, who's praising me? He's coming to say, come back to who's practicing effectively. That's it. He's already here, and he said, okay, who's practicing? Who's practicing effectively enough they can relate to me as a friend instead of something, an idol? Because when you're praising, you're looking for an idol. He says, we're not supposed to praise the Son. The Sonship is not supposed to praise itself. Praise is only for the Father. That's what Jesus said. But not the Son. It's inappropriate. He doesn't want to be praised or worshipped that way. Certainly we can give gratitude, but he comes back in friendship. He said, I'm here to relate with everyone in friendship. So when we're practicing effectively, then we realize, hey, I'm capable of being a friend of Jesus because I can stay in the non-judgmental condition. And then I too can say, hey, let's forgive the past and let's let it go. It's all good. Let's just honor our creativity, which is what he's telling us we need to do. So to be a friend of Jesus, you got to be sort of resonate with his ideas, right? And this is, and so, to stay in this non-judgmental state, you're then able to easily resonate with his perspective. So the past is less and less and less intimidating to me now. Really it is. You know, learning about Christianity, what really took place, is quite astonishing. It's not anything like we really understand. Even if you go to Catholic school and Catholic high school, they're just telling you the Catholic version of it, okay? And if you get just a secular education and government-run schools or homeschooling, you know, you probably don't have a clue. Most people really are absolutely clueless. You went on society and asked them, explain the history of Christianity to me now, you know, how it unfolded, etc. Blah, 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 I don't know. You know. What could they say? What could they say? They really don't know. And yet really our thinking and our way of being in this world has largely been determined by that. Whether we like it or not. And there's the spider again. Good grief, spider. Can you not go over here with my little friend and just hang out there? Okay. Very great. whether we like it or not, and, you know, just saying, well, let's go back to the, you know, paganism, you know, the way it, no. That's not indicated at all. I mean, paganism is not less and less intimidating to me also. And chthonic, you know, the chthonic pagan deities coming from underneath the earth. And they had the ones from the sky, then the ones underneath the earth. And they would, you know, all the sacrifice that they did and the rituals. And pagan religion is just, it's terrible, you know. I mean, there's some nice things you can say about it. But it's not what we really want at all. You know, do we have to be just honest? Is it what we really want? Absolutely not. Absolutely not. I have no interest in going back to pagan religion. I don't have any interest in going back to Christian religion either, the way that it's been either. So we need to move forward. And certainly technology isn't the answer at all. that's the worst of all, actually. So we have what we need to do is move on with right practice. That's all. That's all that's being said here. This is how we move on. We through right practice. And the cornerstone of right practice is full stop in the wow, where you don't struggle with the upheaval in the change in your landscape. It's a shock to your continuity, to your familiarity. It's a continuity shock. And how you deal with that success of continuity shock is all important. So there is a discipline of remaining still, of not taking action, of not neither taking physical action nor mental action. Three aspects to the teaching. There's assertions, like I am both and neither, absolutely abiding in the heart and absolutely not abiding in the heart. Short version, you can just say I'm absolutely abiding in the heart and absolutely not abiding in the heart. I am absolutely learning and absolutely not learning. I'm absolutely intimidated and absolutely not intimidated. I absolutely am understanding and absolutely am not understanding. And you can go on and on and go deeper and deeper in all sorts of various ways. You can call those assertions. The full stop and the wow is when you, by thinking this way, zeroing out concepts, you just say, wow, this is completely different than what I'm used to. It's not Christianity as we know it. It's not paganism as we know it. It's just something else altogether. It's not Gnosticism. It's not any of it. It's not even, what do you call it? Platonic philosophy. You can't really say it's anything. But it's the most effective, profound practice there is. It's zeroing out concepts. So you feel this wow. And you just have to remain in neutral, neither progressing nor regressing, advancing or retreating, not going off to a side this way or that way. Just put your mind in neutral and don't think about it. Don't try to figure out, well, is this being effective or not? Well, just the fact that the wow is there, you know it's already been effective. The whole landscape has been completely changed on you. Perspective has shifted. So we just give ourselves time to just adjust to that. That's it. That's the most important part of spiritual practice. Because if you don't do this right, the wheels will come off and you'll stop doing the assertions. You'll stop doing them. Because you say, I can't handle this. It's too strong for me. So you'll stop. So the whole key to success is full stop in the wow. That's how I call this, walking together in the wow. That's the key to it all. So we have to put this at the center of the entire situation. Not that you have to be some mute. Not that you have to sit quietly all the time. It's that you have this commitment that I'm not going to take action. I'm not going to plan. I'm not going to strategize. I'm not going to scheme. I'm not going to argue. I'm not going to do anything in my mind. I'm just going to sit quietly here patiently. Like I'm just sort of waiting. Waiting to calm down. And when you have confidence and prove to yourself you can do this, then you're not afraid of intense practice. You're not afraid of discovering information that is very helpful to you. I remember that for me, a couple days ago, almost a week now maybe, I remember the moment where I realized that, my God, there was almost a million Jews in Alexandria. And that just blew my mind. I never even imagined any such thing at all. I said, wait a minute, you know, Alexandria? What's Alexandria? Why is Alexandria important? I mean, why were there a million Jews in Alexandria? How is that possible? You know, and I realized my whole understanding of the past was not on a right foundation. And it's just like, wow, it really hit me hard. That means I have to do some work. Well, I've done it. I'm not a stranger to work, hard work, that is for sure. And neither can you or anybody be a stranger to hard work. And this is a hard line. I mean, the church has taken way too soft a line. I mean, if you want to be a true Christian, you have to do the work to justify it. You just can't paint a symbol on your shield, go into battle and say, hey, I'm a Christian. It doesn't work that way. And tough love is very important, because you have to tell people this is what you got to do. If you tell them lies and say, no, you just eat a wafer and you're saved, then they'll say, oh, great, okay, I don't have to do all this work. I just take it easy and just do what the minimum to get by, and that's good enough. Well, you're not doing them any favors at all by saying this, because it doesn't work. And, you know, they'll come to greatly regret their laziness at some point. So taking the hard line is the right line. The hard line is the right line. And we got all these sob sisters who want to go back to being the pagan priestesses and being always right and like that. And well, that's too bad, because that doesn't work. So we're not going to give wrong advice to people just to make them feel better in the short term. You have to look at the long term and say what works, and give them right advice, and then later on they won't regret it. Oh, at least I got some right advice. Someone took a hard line with me. Thank God. And the people you really respect, the people who took the hard line, the tough position, and said, you know, which is something that we're getting back that a little bit. Trump is taking the hard line on all sorts of stuff that we thought was impossible. You know, this is just on a superficial, but it's what's happening in the world right now. So I comment on it because it's what's happening. He takes a very hard line on a lot of stuff, and then he's now being a little putting nuance into it, you know. But the fact of the matter is, there are hard lines that need to be drawn in the sand. Hard lines have to be taken, because we are just simply way too soft. We've gone way too soft as a country, and we've lost that hard line for sure, which is what we used to have. We used to have that. We absolutely used to have that. And now all we do is we apologize to everybody. You know, that's all we do, is just some apology tour. And, you know, and just go soft as a country. We're just, no, hard lines are bad. That's terrible. Of course, we're getting constantly hard lines on that. You must not draw hard lines. Those are the hard lines we're getting now, which are the wrong type of hard lines. You know, those who know should draw the hard lines for society. So you get someone like Trump, who knows his business, for sure, how to draw hard lines and how to succeed and win. Well, he said, okay, this is, you know, you need to draw hard lines here and here and here. We got debt is $20 trillion, and, you know, that's not sustainable. We're going to collapse as a country. And now you get, you know, here's another thing that, you know, what did Jesus do in the temple? Well, he threw out the money changers. He highlighted the problem with money changers, and the problem with money changers has really been going on throughout history. They're really the ones behind a lot of the revolutions and troubles we've had throughout history. There's a class of people who have this skill of money changing, so to speak, currency and money and things like that. Behind the scenes, they control a lot of world events, actually, and that's coming to light apparently. Apparently, that there's a very famous money changer right now in the world, who is apparently fomenting civil unrest in the United States. Ferguson situation, which is just a real, you know, wow. It's just showing how far civilization has collapsed, and how people who are directly trying to foment chaos to further their plans. This is all part of this plan of bringing the United States down into chaos. Well, it's supposedly being funded by this very notably devious money changer, without any question, and has actually been funding the whole thing and like a chess, moving the pieces of a chessboard to actually bring about this kind of, you know, riotous, chaotic situations. And so Jesus, well, the only ones he really cracked down on were the money changers. Very interesting. And so we're becoming more aware of this kind of stuff now. And the hard line we need to take is in our own life, actually. But if there's a mood that, you know, it's okay to take a hard line again, like, you know, Trump's basically saying, hey, It's okay to take a hard line. We need to get back to business. Well, we need to get back to our personal business, right? And our personal business is really salvation. And the churches are not drawing a hard enough line on anything right now. I can guarantee you they're not. I've been assessing the whole situation to see and trying to determine in a very fair, just way, what really do you do about it? Well, we can go to Jesus and the Holy Spirit and ask. Hopefully we'll get some guidance right now. But in our personal lives, we have to draw a hard line and say, you know what, I've got to practice. And for some reason, we don't quite seem to have the juice to do this. Maybe Jesus will give us the juice to do this. Like Trump is giving many people the juice to say, hey, wait a minute, you know, I don't have to back down here. Now, one of Trump's big things is he talks over reporters, which nobody does anymore. Yeah, you just don't do that. And as I was hearing today, the radio, somebody was asking him, a reporter was asking him a question, and then he answered the question, and then the reporter tried to jump in there and say, wait a minute, you know, blah, blah. And Trump just keeps talking. He just keeps talking. He doesn't stop. And the reporter keeps saying, wow, rah, 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 no. And Trump pushed through, and then he made his point. He didn't stop. He refuses to stop just because a reporter tells him he has to back down and stop. He won't do it. And it's like, I was like, what? You know, you mean you can actually do that? I thought it was impossible to do that. I thought when the reporter speaks, you automatically have to stop speaking. You know, it's like, it's ingrained in us, you know. And somehow these things are not ingrained in him. And it's stunning to the people of the United States, Israel. We're being stunned on a daily basis to say, hey, wait a minute. Yeah, reporters, are they elected? You know, who are these reporters anyway? They're mostly pot stirrers, aren't they? I mean, they stir the pot so to generate conflict, which generates eyeballs on the television or sales. You know, conflict sells. If it bleeds, it leads. And there's some professional pot stirrers, and he just, you know, if they're trying to stir the pot, he just goes, well, talks right over him. And eventually he just crushes them. And it's like, wow. It's like a revelation. I mean, you can actually do that? Are you kidding me? And he doesn't back down from a female reporter if she tries to crush him. You know, he doesn't allow that either, which is, you know, just astonishing to most of us. This is like, well, that's just, you know, heresy. Of course, if the female says back down, you've got to back down. I mean, she's uncomfortable. It might affect her pregnancy or, you know, or make her, you know, get out of balance, you know, she might not be a perfect oracle, you know, might not be able to function properly as an oracle. My gosh, we can't have that, you know, but hey, we're not into oracles. So we're into, you know, we're into accessing the Holy Spirit individually like this. And if a reporter's trying to mess with that, hey, we're not going to back down. Absolutely not. So we have to ride the wave of momentum of these times. This is the apocalypse, folks. And hopefully this is starting to register and say, wow. This is the apocalypse. I've been saying this and saying this and saying this and saying this. And if you can't see it yet, you know, wow, maybe in a few days you will. we've got just incredible divide taking place. And just because Christianity hasn't delivered the magic that we thought we would, we thought it was some kind of magic. It's not magic. Right spiritual practice is just setting our arrogance down. And it's not arrogant to set our arrogance down. If somebody tries to say it is, well, we have every right to stand up to that. It's absolutely not arrogant to set arrogance down. It's arrogant to not set it down. Because that means you think that you can change the will of gods, and you're still trying to do so, which means believing in magic, okay? And so we have to keep pushing this. And so far, you know, people are like too frightened. Nobody's saying anything. Nobody's commenting. Nobody's just like silence. There's absolute silence to everything I've been doing. Because I think people are in shock. You know, it's like, is this the apocalypse? It is the apocalypse. And I'm riding the wave. And I've heard other people say, hey, you know, I don't feel so intimidated anymore. But you got to start, you know, unthawing from your deep freeze. And, you know, nobody's going to put us back into a deep freeze. I don't care who it is. I don't care if it's someone saying, "Well, I'm going to be the Oracle." I mean, this female reporter that got into with Trump. I mean, I think she fancies herself as she's going to be the Oracle for this country. I mean, this is really what I get. I saw this coming from a long time ago when I noticed her on the Fox News channel. It's like I said, "Who the heck is this?" I mean, she's got an agenda like you can't believe. So now it's coming to the front. And so there are these pagan priestesses that are coming to the front and telling everybody else to stand down, and we're not going to stand down. We're responding to the fact that Jesus is back, you see? So they can't use the fact that Christianity's collapsing to get us to stand down, because I'm saying that Jesus is already back in this world, and we have every right then now to start attuning to that, which means right spiritual practice. So, which is this practice of saying, yes, I'm both listening to you and not listening to you. I'm both absolutely listening to you and absolutely not listening to you. I'm absolutely not standing down and absolutely standing down. I'm absolutely accepting you as the Oracle and absolutely not accepting you as the Oracle. You see, this is the right practice. And of course, they don't understand, you know, what are you talking about? They want to say, well, everybody need right judgment, so here I am, you know, I'm the right judge. I'm the Oracle of Delphi. I'm the new Pythia. I'm the new, you know, this. I'm the new Celtic pagan priestess. And we say, you know, yeah, absolutely, yes, I accept you as a new priestess, and I also don't accept you as a new priestess. They say, whoa, where's the right judgment? Remember, the ego says we find happiness through right judgment. Jesus says we find happiness through no judgment. This is the difference. Jesus is back. He's calling us to no judgment. This is what we're doing. Okay. So this is how we overcome the apocalypse. And we're apocalyptic survivors. We're apocalyptic thrivers. We're apocalyptic ascenders, whatever you want to call it. Yeah, I would even talk over Trump. I can even talk over Trump if we get into this issue right here. That would be an interesting world. Maybe we need to get into a WrestleMania steel cage or something, and then sit there and see who can talk over the other one. Ultimately, you know, I'll talk him under the table. Because Jesus is back. He is back. He is back. And says, don't worry that Christianity's crumbling. It's okay. Don't worry about it. I'm not worried about it at all. Not in the slightest bit. If it all suddenly dropped away this instant, it wouldn't affect me at all, really. Not that I wanted to drop away. I mean, again, I'm honoring our creativity. We did a great job. We tried a lot. We got pushed onto a side trip, but that's part of recognizing that, saying, oh, okay, now let's get it back on track again. At least we made an effort, you see. And that's what's important. Showing up, making, you know, is half the effort. Half done is once begun is half done, actually. So we've got it half done, but half done is not good enough, because we have this now the continuity problem, which could turn us back into paganism, oracleism, tribalism, and bureaucracy. Worshipping, you know, I mean, a lot of people worship the mortician in chief in the White House, the funeral home we call the White House right now. And he speaks like an oracle, you know, he's speaking like he's, you know, even tried to present himself as like some Oracle of Delphi by having an Apollo temple in was it 2008, was it, the election? Yeah, it was that in Denver, where he comes in and there's a stage, this is Greek stage, like, you know, like the temple of Apollo, and he comes in like he's this god, like Zeus or something. And what they really were doing was they're invoking the pagan oracle archetype that progressives are headed towards, because they don't see any other option. They feel Christianity's failed them, so where else is it? Go back into paganism. And so he actually tapped into this idol worshiping this oracle archetype, and people then, you know, were fainting and seeing him as if he were an oracle. Actually, they were acting like as he was the oracle, and he's continued that shtick for the last 6.5 years of, listen to me, I'm an oracle. I'm the oracle. And of course, Christians say, what are they talking about? We go to the Holy Spirit for our information. We don't go to any oracle. This is ridiculous. So I don't think there's the problem. The progressives in this United States are clueless about the way they're viewed by Christians, for instance. They don't have a clue. They just really don't get it at all. Because they don't even believe in the Holy Spirit. They believe in oracles. And so they don't understand what the resistance, why these crazy conservatives, what's the matter with them? They're nutcases. What do you mean, Holy Spirit talking to God? What about, that's crazy. Now, we go to this state oracle here, you know, the mortician in chief, and this is where we get our marching orders, and, you know, this is straight from, you know, what is right and just, and this is the real God, you know. And they don't get it at all. So there's this huge divide, huge, huge divide. Of course, Christians are taught that the Holy Spirit, as Jesus told us, he would send us the Comforter to make all things clear to us, that we didn't understand what his teaching was at all back then. He said, you don't get it, but eventually you got to listen to the Holy Spirit and you'll get it. So there's this complete divide, absolute divide. I've never heard a liberal talk about the Holy Spirit and say they ask the Holy Spirit for guidance. Nah, that's like heresy to them. I said, are you crazy? We're just looking for the right celebrity to be our oracle. And really, right? I mean, they're idolaters, and oh, this you know, this celebrity or this talk show host on television said this. And they're looking at it like people used to go to oracles at Delphi. You know, they, oh my gosh, there's the oracle. And, you know, they're like hanging on every word, and it's infallible. You know, whatever it says, completely infallible. And they're asking for questions about their lives. What do I do? What do I, you know, please, oracle, tell me. And then the priestess would say some ambiguous statement, say, oh, that's great. So you get these people on television, these talk show people, just to see the way the audience acts to all this. They're like, oh, I'm listening to the oracle. You know, this is so important. I'm getting it. I'm getting the answer to my how to be happy, you know. Instead of doing what the Holy Spirit asks us to do, which is right spiritual practice. The Holy Spirit, you ask the Holy Spirit what I do with my life, basically you're going to get told, keep practicing. That's pretty much all I ever get. You know, I keep saying to the Holy Spirit, but what do I do with, you know, and the Holy Spirit says, just keep practicing. Don't worry about it. Just keep practicing. People are not listening to that. But this is essential. So when I get in trouble and stress, I just write back, okay, I'm not a body, I'm free, I'm still spirit exactly as God created me, and put faith in that. Glass is half full. You have to practice with this glass is half full trust in the Holy Spirit. So the best part of Christianity is trust in the Holy Spirit. You know, if we look, if you want to summarize Christianity, it's easy. Trust in the Holy Spirit. That's it. Nothing more. We don't need anything more. Trust in the Holy Spirit. We say, well, what's the Holy Spirit? Well, the Holy Spirit is really the Son of God reminding itself that it is the Son of God. That's the Holy Spirit. And that this whole thing is a pretense. The Holy Spirit knows time, space, process, form is actually a pretense, like a dream. There's no reality. There's no self-existent reality to it whatsoever. None. Zero. And nothing has happened to the perfection that Son of God. Nothing has happened to his perfection. It can't die. It cannot die. It's impossible. So Christianity summed up, listen to the Holy Spirit, do what the Holy Spirit says in terms of practice. If you're not practicing, you're not listening to the Holy Spirit. Let's put it that way. You're not really doing what it will guide you into practicing. It's not going to guide you in how to get A's, you know, in your classroom necessarily. Not that it can't, but it's going to say, you know, what is the practice you're doing? You know, how are you practicing? Let's see if we can get that better. Let's improve your practicing. This is how I've experienced the Holy Spirit. Let's improve your practicing. And it will clue you into all sorts of clues that help your motivation. Absolutely, it will set your attention. It plays with your attention. It says, look here, look there, notice this, notice that. Okay, now use that momentum to, you know, help you practice. And full stop in the wow is the heart of the practice, because you will succeed. You will feel that you're succeeding, and this will make you feel like, wow, I didn't realize I could stop pretending to be dead. This is really astonishing. I'm really not dead at all. I'm just pretending. None of this has any grip on me at all. None of this sickness has the slightest grip. None of this tiredness, none of this suffering has the slightest grip on me whatsoever, actually. Nothing does. I'm totally untouchable. And so practicing like this, you know, this is the Holy Spirit. So again, we can forgive our side trip. We said, you know, at least we got out of it to listen to the Holy Spirit. That's what's all important. That's what Jesus told us to do. Very simple. So we don't need all these disputes and spats. We don't need to be divisive among one another. We can forgive one another. Let's all Christianity forgive one another. Let's everyone in the world, whatever tradition, forgive one another for all our side trips and get back to asking the Holy Spirit, which is simply advising us to write spiritual practice, which enables us to honor our creativity, okay, before we then truly, completely move on. And we really have to honor our creativity. We don't want to just chuck at the whole universe. We've put too much effort into it. We've put so much effort into it that we're not just going to throw it aside. So we're going to honor it. So we have to honor it in a flattened out condition so we're not judging. And when we don't judge, we act as reflectors to the reality that we are. And we seem to reflect it within our being. And we feel like we're on fire. Then we're just like, wow, I'm just feeling this. I'm so totally in the groove. And we have to keep abiding in that groove more and more and more and more. And you do this through right practice by flattening out concepts. Flattening out, zeroing out concepts. Okay. So we say, and you can use like, anybody you feel like an authority over you or something, you just say like the Caesars, the emperors, or the political candidates, and say, hey, I absolutely love Trump and absolutely don't love Trump. I absolutely love Hillary Clinton and I absolutely don't love Hillary Clinton. I absolutely love, you know, Ted Cruz and absolutely don't love Ted Cruz. I absolutely love the Mortician in Chief and absolutely don't love the Mortician in Chief. I absolutely love Iran and absolutely don't love Iran. Whatever it is that's intimidating. Russia, Putin. I both and neither absolutely love Putin and absolutely don't love Putin. You see, whoever it is, whatever it is that you feel is intimidating to you, use this practice. Zero it out. And then you will start feeling, hey, I feel like I'm sort of, somehow I'm spiritual. I can't really explain it. I can both and neither absolutely explain it and not explain it. See, yes, I absolutely can explain, absolutely cannot explain it. See how you zeroed it out and you need to use judgment? Nobody, the ego cannot corner you into judgment. And you can use that throughout history. Yeah. Any figure, Jesus, Moses, Abraham, Buddha, you name it. Yes, I absolutely love Buddha, and I absolutely don't love Buddha. Yes, I absolutely love Moses, and I absolutely don't love Moses. Whatever you want to use. Jesus, I both and neither absolutely love Jesus, and absolutely don't love Jesus. See, this, what this does, zeroes out the concept of loving Jesus, or not loving it. Both. It zeroes out all of it, right? And then where's the judgment? There's nothing to judge. Nothing to judge. When you say, yes, I love Jesus, then you start judging. Well, is that true? See, you're judging. So when you take a stand or make a point or stand, automatically you're cornered into judgment. This is what the ego wants. This is why people are not practicing properly. The ego keeps informing them instead of they don't listen to the Holy Spirit, they listen to the ego. Because they got this wrong notion the Holy Spirit somehow tied up in the Nicene Creed, the Chalcedonian Creed, the filioque, you know, distraction. Somehow this is something to do with the Holy Spirit. No, the Holy Spirit is completely free of time. It's not caught up in any of that. It's just absolutely focused on getting us to practice correctly. The Holy Spirit's never been tripped up. There's no schisms in the Holy Spirit. It's beyond concepts. Okay, you cannot be touched by concepts. Our confusion with concepts and judgment don't touch the Holy Spirit at all. So it remains the perfect advisor, always will be. And now there are people that get this. It's just you need to, like for me, I progressed and pressed for so long through different practices, because this particular practice here, I mean, who would ever thought of such a thing? The ego will never inform you of that. Who will inform you of that? Only the Holy Spirit will. And Jesus, of course, being, fully awakened to no more pretense of death at all, certainly is aware of right spiritual practice. And there are others who have awakened also aware of it. Not only in Christian tradition, but other traditions. But right now, we have the juice to say it right here, right now, and apply it to everything in our life, actually, including these people in trends that may seem like oracles to us. So we say, hey, lady news reporter, I both absolutely love you and absolutely don't love you. I think you're absolutely fabulous, and I think you're absolutely not fabulous. Hey, or hey, Delphic, or oracle to be, you're absolutely fabulous, and you're absolutely not fabulous. Okay, you're both neither absolutely fabulous and absolutely not fabulous. You see how it just liberates us, like right here, right now. We're liberated right now. There's no future. There's no past or future. There's no time in the statement. It's zeroed out. It's zeroed out. Nothing to judge. We say, well, I absolutely think you're fabulous. Well, then we'll judge. Well, do you really, as time goes on, can you prove that you're going to say it's fabulous? Or if you say it's not fabulous, how can you prove that you're not going to change, your position? So we get caught up in this judgment. Whereas we say, no, both and neither, you're absolutely fabulous and absolutely not fabulous. Poof. The entire thing is just, both is just zeroed out like that. And then we just feel like centered right here, right now. And we need to do this to honor our creativity. We will not just throw everything that we've tried to do, just have it just disappear. Decide, okay, let's just let it all disappear this instant. Nobody's going to do that. And nobody should pressure anyone to do that. Because we've done a fantastic job. Our creativity is an incredibly fantastic job at this whole pretense of trying to appear to be thanically dead so that we can try to be greater than God. We've done a fantastic job at that. And so we're going to honor our creativity. Just looking back through history, I just say, wow. What a pageantry and what a drama, and what a passion we had for all of this, and look at everything we've tried to do, and wow, a lot of creativity put into it. So let's just take the fact that it's zero content. There's no content to it, so very little, and let's just flatten it all out. Because we know what right practice now, how to get to the content is to reflect reality through cleaning the mirror, and the fog on our mirror is judgment. The fog of judgment is what fogs our mirror up. So when we defog our mirror, this is when the light of truth begins to shine in us. And so we do that by flattening, zeroing out concepts. There's nothing to judge right here, right now. I've already, it ends time, doesn't it? I know you're absolutely fabulous, and I know you're absolutely not fabulous. Okay? End of time right there. You can say that about anyone. Don't be afraid. Don't think that Jesus is saying, well, aren't you saying that I'm fabulous? No, Jesus is saying, don't judge, lest you be judged. So we say, hey, Jesus, you're both and neither, both and neither, that I know you're absolutely fabulous and I know you're absolutely not fabulous. It's both and neither that I know you're absolutely fabulous and you're absolutely not fabulous. Both of those and neither of those, you see. Jesus will say, great, you're defogging your mirror, which is what you need to do. See, don't turn to me as an idol, as an oracular idol. to worship, say, let me feed you, sacrifice this and this, and you tell us, are we going to win this battle and war or something? No, defog the mirror within you, and then the divinity that you are will be reflected off of that. This is what you have to do. So he says, by all means, say both and neither, both and neither that I say yes, both and neither that I see Jesus. I see Jesus as absolutely fabulous, and I don't see Jesus as absolutely fabulous. Like that. So we say Jesus is absolutely fabulous, and Jesus is not absolutely fabulous. Both and neither Jesus is fabulous, and Jesus is not fabulous. Both and neither Jesus is absolutely fabulous, and Jesus is not absolutely fabulous. Both and neither. And the fog is disappearing on the mirror. Getting defogged. We've been in a very foggy state. And when you're in a foggy state, the divine doesn't reflect. Because we want to honor our creativity, so there has to be a reflection of the divine. And so it doesn't reflect when it's all foggy. And all this arguing and dialogue and discussion and stuff, that doesn't defog the mirror at all. I've done a lifetime of that. It didn't defog it at all. It doesn't defog it. It's only these practices that defog it. It might just do a tiny bit, but then it fogs right back up again. Judgment jumps in and says, wow, you defogged the mirror. You think you can keep it defogged? And how long do you think you can keep it defogged? And how did you manage to defog it? Do you think there might be some better way to defog it? And just fogs right up again. But here we say, yeah, I absolutely am defogging the mirror, and I'm absolutely not defogging the mirror. I'm absolutely practicing, and I'm absolutely not practicing. What time is it? It's past 1 o'clock in the morning. See, I slept. I took a nap. I just when I came home. I just slept for a couple hours. I absolutely was just knocked out. My goodness. So yeah, I'm absolutely defogging, and I'm absolutely not defogging. What is there to judge there? You see. And then the wow comes. Like wow, I'm not judging. Wow, this is amazing. I'm not used to this. Yeah, who is used to it? You can say, I'm absolutely pro-Clinton, and I'm absolutely not pro-Clinton. Because politics is ruling the day right now. It's crazy. How many more months? We still have like 16, and we still have a long way to go. August, September, October. So the elections are all to be in November. So 3 and 12 is 15. 15 more months to go. 14 and a half. A little more than that. And so, oh my God, it's just a long, long time. So, well, yeah, sure. Say, I absolutely favor Clinton, and I absolutely don't favor Clinton, for instance. I absolutely favor Trump, and I absolutely do not favor Trump. I absolutely do favor Trump, and I absolutely do not favor Trump, and I'm very smart. Yes, I'm very smart. And I can't say I'm very rich, because that's not true. I'm very competent. I'm very smart. I know exactly what to do here. Yes, I'm for Trump, and absolutely I'm not for Trump. Absolutely I'm for Clinton, and I'm absolutely not for Clinton. It just, see, this is how to deal with it. This is how to deal with the whole thing. Absolutely the Democrats have done a great job, and absolutely they have not done a great job. Absolutely the Republicans are going to do a great job, and absolutely they're not going to do a great job. Right? Like that. Zero it out, whatever it is. That Iran treaty, that treaty is absolutely a great treaty and absolutely not a great treaty. I'm absolutely for this treaty and absolutely not for this treaty. The asteroid's absolutely going to hit and it's absolutely not going to hit. Whatever it is that is catching your attention, just throw it into this mill of right spiritual practice. I absolutely love this country and I absolutely do not love this country. I absolutely support this issue and I absolutely don't support this issue. See, I absolutely, yes, I both and neither absolutely support Obamacare and absolutely do not support Obamacare, for instance. That's a big issue. Planned Parenthood, you can say the same thing, whatever hot button issue. Yeah, yes, I both and neither absolutely support Planned Parenthood and absolutely do not support Planned Parenthood. Like abortion, that's a big issue. I absolutely support, yes, I both and neither absolutely support abortion and absolutely do not support abortion. Gay marriage. Yes, I both and neither absolutely support gay marriage and absolutely do not support gay marriage. Okay? Do like that? Pharmaceutical culture. Yes, I both and neither absolutely do support pharmaceutical culture and I absolutely do not support pharmaceutical culture. Now, people say we're crazy. Well, the early Christians, they called them crazy. You know, maybe they were practicing properly back then. And eventually, you know, they'd say, hey, you guys, you know, you got to stop doing that. You're crazy. Well, they'd certainly think we're crazy right now, don't we, by practicing this way. But we're not crazy like a fox. Effective. As I am absolutely effective, and I'm very smart in being effective, and I know how to be effective, and I'm more effective than other people are being effective, and I know, you know, you can do that. Like, yes, I'm absolutely effective and absolutely not effective. Yes, I'm both and neither absolutely effective and absolutely not effective. What are we doing? Zeroing out, flattening concepts, zeroing out judgment, defogging the mirror of our mind, so reflection of divinity, which is isness of divinity, can be reflected in our mind. That's what we're doing. Is that crazy? No, it's the opposite of crazy. Is this arrogant? No, it's the opposite of arrogance. It's setting our arrogance down. How dare we think we can change what we are? How dare we think we can change the will of God? This is complete arrogance, sheer arrogance. So we're just practicing setting our arrogance down is all. Spiritual CPR. Now, I advocate taking the whole thing head on. Surf, you got to surf the apocalypse. Don't go into a fetal position. It's not going to work well, I don't think. Because you might come out of that fetal and say, oh my gosh, you know, it's too much for me. So embrace the whole situation and use this practice. Whatever comes up to you, say just, yeah. You know, what's the contratemps of the day? I don't know. As it's 1 o'clock in the morning, I'm sure by tomorrow there'll be some other contretemps, you know. Actually, I absolutely support this issue, and I absolutely don't support this issue. Whatever it is, whatever it is to you, whatever it is, just and use that. Say, oh, great, more grist for the mill. Throw it in the mill. Let's grind it. Let's flatten it out here. Let's zero out judgment on this one, too. You can say, Christians, do they absolutely support the Nicene Creed and Nicene Creed, and absolutely don't support the Nicene Creed. I absolutely am a Chalcedonian, and I'm absolutely not a Chalcedonian Christian. I absolutely support the Filioque, and I absolutely don't support the Filioque. I absolutely support the schism, and I absolutely do not support the schism. I absolutely support the Pope, and I absolutely do not support the Pope. Yes, I both and neither absolutely support the Pope, and I absolutely do not support the Pope. As you say it very emphatically, that it's not equivocal at all. You're being completely unequivocal in your statement. Each one, you say, I absolutely do support the Pope, and I absolutely do not support the Pope. So both statements are made in an unequivocal manner. Okay, don't start equivocating at all. That is not going to be effective, because then judgment jumps in. Say, wait a minute, how much of the one and how much of the other? See, we don't allow judgment. We're not saying how much of one or the other. We're making absolute statements on both of these. I absolutely support the Pope, and I absolutely do not support the Pope. Okay, what is judgment to do with this? Nothing. Judgment says, give me some form where I can breathe. You know, say, no, judgment, we're not giving you any oxygen anymore. No spiritual oxygen to judgment, because that fogs up the mirror. You breathe on a mirror, it fogs up the mirror, right? So let's not give the breath of judgment to our spiritual mirror of the mind within us. Yeah, I can talk about the studio. Isn't this a great studio? Isn't this wonderful here? I built a studio. You know, yeah, it's a fabulous studio. I build great studios. I build backdrops. I make great videos here. Yeah, I absolutely make great videos, and I absolutely don't make great videos. I absolutely build great backdrops, and I absolutely don't build great backdrops. See, this is where it's really at. What was Trump's latest? I'm a whiner. Yeah, absolutely, I'm a whiner. They say, well, you're whining. You know, you're so whiny. Oh, absolutely, I'm the world's greatest whiner. I whine and I whine and I whine till I win. I whine till I win. Well, we can say, absolutely, I'm crazy. I'm the world's greatest. I'm absolutely perfectly crazy. I'm the world's greatest perfect crazy. Yes, absolutely. And I'm also not the world's greatest perfect crazy. I'm absolutely crazy. I'm absolutely not crazy. So, you know, agree with your adversary. That's what Trump did. They said, why, what a whiner. How can we have a whiner in the White House? Yeah, I whine and whine and whine until I win. I'm the best in the world at it. I will whine. I will whine in negotiations until I win. So we say, yeah, we will practice until we clear the fog off our mirror. We will practice, absolutely. Absolutely, I'm absolutely completely crazy and absolutely not completely crazy. I'm absolutely crazy and absolutely not crazy. Put it that way. I'm absolutely crazy and I'm absolutely not crazy. Or I'm absolutely sane and I'm absolutely not sane. I'm absolutely this and I'm absolutely not this. I'm absolutely that and I'm absolutely not that. I'm absolutely that tree and I'm absolutely not that tree. See, I'm absolutely the sky and I'm absolutely not the sky. I'm absolutely this world and I'm absolutely not this world. I'm absolutely the universe, and I'm absolutely not the universe. And I'm absolutely going to win, and I'm absolutely not going to win. So you just practice this way, and you're going to feel the wow. And then you just have to practice full stop in the wow, which is you give yourself time. Maybe a little comfort food, a little, some rest. I take a lot of naps, rest. I said, wow. After, you know, a lot of times after I tape, you know, the wow is so strong. I just have, you know, I feel like just resting for a while. Not thinking about anything. Not listening to music. Not doing anything. Just be neutral. Just be with it. And just say, what is this wow? Let me just be with this wow. Let me take a break. Let me cool down. Full stop in the wow. Not judging. How did I do? How did I not do? Yeah, because I know I did great and I did not do great. Yes, I did absolutely great and I did absolutely not great. I'm absolutely great and I'm absolutely not great. I'm absolutely fabulous and absolutely not fabulous. I'm absolutely kind, and I'm absolutely not kind. I'm absolutely generous, and I'm absolutely not generous. I'm absolutely smart, and I'm absolutely not smart. I'm absolutely the spirit, and I'm absolutely not the spirit. I'm absolutely the truth, and I'm absolutely not the truth. I'm absolutely free, and I'm absolutely not free. These are all concepts we're zeroing out. So when we zero out concepts, what's left to reflect in our defogged mirror? The truth. That's what's reflecting there then. So once we get rid of the fog, whatever is there as truth is automatically going to reflect then. We don't have to make it so. It's going to be so automatically. So I could both talk all night and not talk all night. But I do have to get some rest and do something tomorrow. I don't know what. work and do something. I kind of slip my mind. Okay. Yeah. It both slipped my mind and didn't slip my mind. I'm both tired and not tired. You practice, practice, practice. And it may just seem like it's mundane sometimes, but other times it gets very intense. Like I'm saying, yes, I absolutely am the universe. And I'm absolutely not the universe. You know, that's very intense. Very intense. I can feel the wow of that when you just emphatically assert both of those absolutes. Assert both those absolutes. Now, of course, truth and lies can't both be true, but we're not asserting either one is true. And it's enough to simply not assert that lies are true. We don't have to assert that truth is true. It's once we defog our mirror, the truth of our being will automatically reflect there without our having to judge for it at all. So don't judge for anything. Don't judge at all. Judging for something is the mistake that the ego then the yeast is thrown into your mind. The yeast of judgment is thrown into your mind. And that becomes massively complicated and confusing and upsetting, and you're just a mess then. So we don't need to judge for truth. Just get rid of judgment altogether, and then the truth will shine. The truth of what is will shine within us. So even the concept of Jesus is fog in our mirror. Any concept, that's judgment. Well, you're for Jesus or against Jesus? Do you think you're going to always be for Jesus? Or how's it going to change? You know, judgment comes into it. We just say, yeah. I say, yes, I'm absolutely for Jesus, and I'm absolutely not for Jesus. What can judgment do? It tries to come into that. Well, you mean, how long are you going to be that way? Well, I'm always going to be that way, and I'm always not going to be that way. How's it going to change? Is it going to be able to change it? Well, yeah, absolutely always be changing, and absolutely always will not be changing. Sure, my position is going to change, and absolutely my position is not going to change. See, this is what you say. This is how you practice. Now, we not likely to be practicing to people in the world like that, right? So you need to do your practice in your mind and give your time to practice like that. Because if you say that to people in the world, they say that you're psychotic or something. They won't know what to say. And you can say, yes, absolutely, I'm psychotic, and absolutely, I'm not psychotic. Whatever they say, well, you got mental problems. I absolutely have mental problems, and I absolutely do not have any mental problems. I absolutely have mental problems, and I absolutely do not have mental problems. You know, no judgment. There's no judgment. Can't get a hold of anything. So where can it be slipping to? The idea that we're slipping into a pit, it's the pit of judgment. If there's no slippery slope anywhere, how can you be slipping anywhere? That's why you stay in the groove. Oh yeah, I'm both staying in the groove and not staying in the groove. Absolutely staying in the groove and absolutely not staying in the groove. Yeah, I'm absolutely responding to the shrieks and absolutely not responding to the shrieks. The oracle shrieking, shh, you know. The oleander leaves are having effect. What did I say that gas was? Ethylene or something like that. Oh, the ethylene gas is having effect. What is going on? Shh, shh, shh. The oracle is about going into a trance. So, maybe too many oleander leaves. The oracle seeming to be falling on the ground like epilepsy or something. You know, we're all, so much of the societies now is trying, shh, shh, shh. The oracle's about ready to speak. You know, quiet. You don't distract the oracle. They're trying to get into a trance. They haven't quite reached that trance state yet. And don't bother them. You know, it'll upset them. Don't say anything that might upset the oracle. You'd call it a war against women, but it's really, don't upset the oracle. They're about ready to go into this trance, and only the oracle can go into this trance. Only the oracle can talk to God and pass on God's will to us, you know. So, yeah, I'm both listening to God and not listening to God. I'm absolutely listening to God and absolutely not listening to God. I'm absolutely listening to the oracle and absolutely not listening to the oracle. Okay, very great. It is getting late, about 1:30 at night. 1:30 in the morning. Maybe some skunk's gonna go walking by, a raccoon or a possum or who knows what. Some creature will come walking by. Someone put up cameras, trail cameras in various places of the world. It's pretty astonishing. I just saw some pictures from one of them. All these big cats, some animals I've never even seen before, never even exist. Holy cow. You know, they go prowling around. There's no question about it. The trail cameras that flash it automatically and motion detection. Pretty amazing stuff. So, before some creature goes wandering past here, let's call it a video here. And stay in the groove. Take it to heart. Realize it is the apocalypse. And yet, we're going to be fine. We're going to be better than fine. We're both going to be fine and not fine, and everything else, and not everything else. And that's it for this one.